Actually, I began this morning with the question, have I ever preached on Esther? I didn't say Easter. I always preach on Easter. That's easy, right? But have I ever preached on Esther, the book of Esther? Maybe once, and I will say I found it to be a big challenge to preach on the book of Esther. And that's okay. It's good to be challenged. It's good to kind of push yourself. But in the book of Esther, there's no mention of God, not by name anyway. There is no recorded prayers. There are no sacrifices. There's not much mention of worship. So it's rather difficult in some ways, but it's a wonderful historical book. There are many, many details. Kind of reads like a history through many of these chapters. And let's look at Esther this morning. If you'd like to turn in your Bibles to the book of Esther, please do. Right before Job's, Psalms, Proverbs, just very near the middle of your Old Testament, the book of Esther. And as you're turning there, the book is named for a Jewish girl named Hadassah. That's her Hebrew name. And I suppose she was given the Persian name of Esther. And Esther begins with talking about this vast Persian empire that stretched from India to Ethiopia. And it mentions the kingdom of Xerxes. Now, Xerxes is kind of like a title, like emperor, right? And he has a Hebrew name as well, but we'll use the name Xerxes. And Xerxes ruled after the death of his father Darius back 486 to 465 BC. So if we looked at the first chapter, we would see that King Xerxes is calling for a six-month-long summit, right? A time that he displays the wealth and the splendor of the Persian Empire, the kingdom. When it's all over, the king gave this extravagant banquet for the people of the capital of Susa in this Persian Empire. And it's interesting, it's true, in chapter 1 we would read that Xerxes drinks too much. That's part of the detail. He orders that his queen, Queen Vashti, be paraded in front of all the people. She refuses. So he says, "What shall we do? Vashti isn't cooperating, disobeying the king's command, and her behavior might influence all the other women in the kingdom," right? So what does he do? He demotes her as queen and begins a search, an extravagant search for all the among all the beautiful women in the kingdom from all the provinces for a new king. Well, this is when Esther is introduced in the second chapter, verse 7. In the second chapter of Esther, we read that Mordecai, and I'll get to him in a minute, had a cousin named Hadassah, whom he had brought up because she had neither father or mother. This girl, who was also known as Esther, was lovely in form and features, and Mordecai had taken her as his own daughter when her father and mother died. So Esther is introduced, and as well, there are two main characters. Mordecai and Esther are both descendants of exiles that were taken into the Babylonian captivity 100 years earlier. And this Xerxes is the grandson of Cyrus the Great, the ruler of Persia, who decreed that the Jews could go back to their land after the 70 years of captivity. And many did and began rebuilding, and we read about that in God's Word. But many stayed, many settled, and were scattered throughout this Persian Empire. Well, moving on quickly, Esther catches the eye of those in charge of this pageant. It's kind of a beauty pageant in a way that's set up to choose a queen. And to make a long story short, she was taken to the king, who sets a royal crown on her head, makes her queen, and gives a feast in Esther's honor. We would read in the 20th verse that Esther keeps her Jewish heritage unknown. That's what Mordecai suggests that she does. And we would also read that Mordecai, her cousin who raises her as his own child, foils a plot to assassinate the king. And that brings us to the third chapter, if you want to turn to chapter 3. In chapter 3, then, we see that Xerxes, the king, elevates a Persian named Haman to prime minister or chief prince, and all bow down to Haman except for Mordecai. Right? And when Haman finds this out, he's furious. He learns that Mordecai is a Jew, and he vows not only to kill Mordecai, but all the Jews through the Persian Empire. All right? And I won't turn to 1 Samuel, the 15th chapter, but you could look there if you want to for some background to explain maybe Haman's hatred for Mordecai's people. So we understand then that Xerxes, the king, agrees with Haman, who has this idea, destroy the Jews. But he didn't know that his queen and Mordecai, the man who had saved his life, were both Jews. But the king takes his signet ring off his finger and hands it to Haman, a way of saying, yeah, it's official. This is the official stamp. And we read then in verses 12 through 15 of chapter 3 that the decree is issued to every corner of the empire. And there's even a specific day that is set to kill, to annihilate all the Jews, verse 13. The young, the old, women, the children, on a single day, the 13th day of the 12th month. So in light of this crisis that is building, Mordecai turns to Esther. And that brings us to chapter 4. And I want to focus on the fourth chapter of Esther today. Follow along if you wish, the first 8 verses of chapter 4. When Mordecai learned of all that had been done, he tore his clothes, he put on sackcloth and ashes, he went out to the city, wailing loudly and bitterly. But he only went as far as the king's gate, because no one clothed in sackcloth was allowed to enter it. In every province to which the edict and order of the king came to kill the Jews, there was great mourning, with fasting, weeping, and wailing. Many lay in sackcloth and ashes. When Esther's maids and eunuchs came and told her about Mordecai, she was in great distress. She sent clothes for him to put on instead of his sackcloth, but he would not accept them. Then Esther summoned Hathach, one of the king's eunuchs assigned to attend her, and ordered him to find out what was troubling Mordecai and why. So this individual goes to Mordecai in the open square of the city in front of the king's gate. Mordecai tells him everything that had happened, including the exact amount of money that Haman had promised to pay into the royal treasury for the destruction of the Jews. He gave him a copy of the text of the edict for their annihilation, which had been published in the capital, to show to Esther and to explain it to her. And he told him to urge her to go into the king's presence to beg for mercy and plead with him for her people. But there's a problem. And we could read on, and the problem is that Esther hadn't been summoned to the king's presence for 30 days. And that may be that she was losing a little favor with the king. I don't know, but we know that it's a great problem, because to approach the king without being invited or summoned is death. And the only way that he or she would be spared is if the king extends his golden scepter, a sign. Yes, come into my presence. So when Mordecai was told this, we have his words in verse 12 through 14, and there are some wonderful words here, including a key verse in all of the book of Esther. So picking up at verse 12, when Esther's words were reported to Mordecai, he sent back this answer. Do not think, Esther, that because you were in the king's house, you alone of all the Jews will escape. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews shall arise from another place, but you and your father's family will perish. And who knows that if you have come to royal position for such a time as this? Again, that verse 14, is a wonderful verse. It's a wonderful thought. It's a key verse in all of Esther. And I say it's a challenge to preach from Esther, but Esther is a true story. Reading very much like history and containing many, many details, but it's a true and relevant story. And I would say this morning that using these words, who knows, for such a time as this, first of all, this is a challenging time in which to live, is it not? These are challenging times in which we live. And I suppose that our parents and our grandparents said the same thing, did they not? But we see so much happening in the world, and maybe that's the problem. We see so much happening. It's across our TV screens. It's on our electronic devices. It comes to us, we are bombarded with information, and so much is happening, and the truth is we all have doubts, and we all have fears, we all have questions. But I say that God doesn't want us to be crippled by anxiety, by our fears, and by our doubts. He wants us to turn to Him. He wants us to trust Him. He wants us to experience His calm, His peace, even in the midst of trouble. I mentioned there is no mention of God directly in this book. It's one of two books in the Bible which God's name is not mentioned. Is God absent? Absolutely not. And maybe the fact that God isn't mentioned heightens this awareness of God's invisible hand at work. The king, the emperor Xerxes, on the other hand, is mentioned 175 times in the book of Esther. I didn't believe that. I started counting, and up to chapter 4, 65 times. So I believe that Xerxes is mentioned by name or by the king 175 times. God's hand is at work. It isn't Xerxes' power that's so evident, but God's power. God's hand is at work in all these details, narrowing down all the young women in this vast empire to a young orphan Jew named Esther, chosen to be queen. God's hand is evident with Mordecai being in such a place to hear about this plot to kill Xerxes. The king extending his hand to Esther. I think God is at work in many more examples in this story as it unfolds in these chapters. But these are challenging times in which we live. I hear it from many of you and from others all the time. And some challenges we bring on ourselves. Others are just because trials and troubles come into all of our lives. But either way, God cares. God greatly cares. And in thinking about a text or a passage that applies to, you know, how do we deal with challenging times today? I think of 1 Peter. 1 Peter 5, verse 7. I'm sure you're familiar with these two verses that I'll reference, but in 1 Peter, the 5th chapter, it's in verse 7 that we read, "Cast all your anxiety upon Him, upon God." Why? Because He cares for you. But we got to understand that verse 7 follows verse 6, and in my translation, it's two separate sentences. In the original Greek, it's all one connecting, flowing thought. Humble yourselves, verse 6. Humble yourselves under God's mighty hand, that He might lift you up in due time. And the way of humbling is seen by casting all your anxiety upon God. We humble ourselves by casting our anxiety upon God. And that humbling, which precedes, can take many forms. Possibly it could be admitting that we've made a mistake, that we're wrong. That's hard to do. It requires humility. Possibly that humbling admits that we're weak and we're inadequate in and of ourselves. And that's hard to do. It requires humility. We want to fix our own problems. We want to, have pride in our achievements and our accomplishments. And it's hard for some, and harder hard for all of us to humble ourselves and to roll all of our cares, our anxiety, onto God. But we can do so, and with the confidence that He really cares. And it was interesting to me in studying this passage to understand that to say God cares is more than, yeah, God cares. I know He cares. To say that God cares is to believe that He will act. And then I remembered, yeah, in the Old Testament when it says that the Lord hears, you know, the righteous cry out to Him in our reading. The righteous cry out and the Lord hears, right? The idea is that He is moved to intervene and to act. And the psalmist continues, He delivers them from all their troubles. So to say He cares, to say He hears, is to say that we're confident that we will experience His favor and His blessing. And in the words of Psalm 4:7, I love these words, from the fourth psalm. In the words of the psalmist in the fourth psalm, it's to know that the Lord's face shall shine upon us, verse 6, that we shall be filled, our hearts shall be filled with greater joy, verse 7. In verse 8, that we shall lie down and sleep in peace. For you alone, O Lord, shall make me to dwell in safety. These are challenging times. I suppose they always have been, but it seems to me they're becoming more challenging. But we're to cast our cares upon God. And for Paul, to the saints in Philippi, that is how? By prayer, by petition, and with thanksgiving, presenting our request to God with the confidence that his peace that transcends our understanding will guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. A second thing, in challenging times, we look to God, knowing that he's fully able to deliver, to bring about his good purposes. So a second thing is to know that God's purposes prevail. God's purposes prevail. And usually in the Old Testament, particularly the Psalms and Proverbs, when I read those words expressed in a variety of way, it's in contrast to man's purposes, man's plans. Many are the plans in a man's heart, but it's the Lord's purpose that prevails. As well, in the 33rd Psalm, we looked at the 34th this morning in our reading, but in the 33rd Psalm, we find some wonderful words in verse 10 and 11. Psalm 33, 10 and 11. We read these words, that the Lord foils the plans of the nations. He thwarts the purposes of the peoples. But by contrast, the plans of the Lord stand firm forever. The purposes of his heart, and to me that means what he intends to accomplish, stand forever through all generations. We can trust in God, our faithful God. He can, he has, and I think he will continue to overrule the plans of men. He did in our story, and we're not getting to the end of Esther today, but Xerxes' decree or counsel was destroy, kill, annihilate. Those are the words we read. All the Jews, from the young to the old. On a specific day, the 13th day of the 12th month, kill them all. It didn't happen. And I would say, au contraire. On the contrary, right? As we'll see perhaps next week. But we don't always see God's purposes. We don't always understand how God is bringing about good in a bad situation. And I thought, you know, it's not till the end of Job. Think about Job. It's not until the very last chapter of Job that we read these words. Lord, my ears had heard of you, but now my eyes have seen you. Well, Job came to understand through the eyes of faith and with spiritual understanding. And he came to accept God's purpose for his life. Think about Joseph. What about Joseph in the Bible? We understand what happened with Joseph and the things, you know, about his brothers. They kidnapped him. They sold him into slavery, did they not? They did what? Did they throw him into a well, or was that somebody else? That was Joseph, right. They lied to his father. That's bad enough. All those things are terrible. Was God pleased? No. But did God use that situation to bring about greater good? Absolutely. And we would read in Genesis, in a couple passages, in the 45th chapter, when Joseph finally makes himself known to his brothers, right, when they come down to see him in Egypt, Joseph says this, I'm your brother Joseph, the one that you sold into Egypt. Do not be distressed and angry with yourselves for selling me here, because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. For 2 years now, there's been a famine in the land. For the next 5 years, there'll be no plowing and reaping, but God sent me ahead of you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. And in the last chapter, the 50th chapter, these wonderful words, he reassures his brothers. He says, don't be afraid. He says, you intended to harm me, But God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. It's God's purposes that prevail. And we think about Romans 8, 28, many people's probably favorite verse in the Bible. Do you know Romans 8, 28? If you do, say it with me. In all things, God works for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. Now, there's some qualifiers there. In all things, God can work for the good. He's able to do anything. He's able to deliver. He works for the good. This is the promise, right? For those who love him, who are called according to his purpose. And to me, that means who have responded in obedience to the call of the gospel. And the next verse, I think, is important. To those who are cooperating with God, who are allowing the Spirit of God to conform their lives more and more into the image of God's Son, Jesus. These are challenging times. God's purpose prevail. His purposes prevail. How important is it to make our plans, our purposes with God, to seek his will, to pray Psalm 119, 133, these words, guide my steps according to your word, O Lord. I don't want sin to rule over me. The third and last thing this morning, and what I gather from this first half, roughly, of Esther, is that God accomplishes his purposes through us, through human beings, and to me, that's amazing enough, right? And I've heard Alva speak many times about, you know, God could have, you know, caused the spread of the gospel in a variety of ways, but he chose, you know, men and women to be messengers and to be responsible and have the wonderful privilege of spreading and sharing the good news message. Mordecai says, Esther, if you remain silent at this time, deliverance will arise from another place. I think he's saying, you know, divine help will come one way or the other, maybe by another individual. But he went on to say, but who knows? Who knows that you've come to royal position for such a time as this? I think we should all highlight Esther 4:14, the latter part of that verse in our Bibles. Who knows? God knows. He knows it all. His ways are perfect. Our ways aren't. But who knows that you've come to such a position for such a time as this? I think we should all consider why, for what purpose has God put us in the place we're in? Have you stopped to think, you know, God has placed me in a position? I think that we all have our unique circumstances, our certainly unique personalities, but our unique relationships, our own sphere of influence where we can be used of God. Should we not pray, God, use me as an instrument in your hand to accomplish your will? Now, if we pray that, it may require some courage. Courage is a big part of the book of Esther. I think it was courageous for Vashti not to give in to the demands of the king. She was demoted, but I don't think it was so great that she was asked to parade around in front of all the people, right? Mordecai refused to bow down to Haman. It took courage. Esther was willing to go before the king, risking her life. And we read in the last verses of the fourth chapter that Esther sent this reply to Mordecai, go gather together all the Jews in Susa, the capital, and fast for me. Now, prayer's not mentioned, but it's hinted at, a part of fasting. Do not eat or drink for 30 hours. No, 3 days and 3 nights. Maybe next year, 3 days. Nope, 3 days. And I and my maids will fast as you do, and when it's done, I will go to the king, even if it's though it's against the law. And she says, if I perish, I perish. And if I perish, I perish. We see the courage of Esther. But more important, the focus is on God. silent, behind the scenes, invisible hand, no direct mention. But God, in the book of Esther, moves in a wonderful way to deliver, to save his people from annihilation. I ask, have you experienced how God has placed people in the right place at the right time? Have you? Have you experienced that God has brought you to such a place or a position for such a time as this? It wasn't coincidence in the book of Esther. God is clearly working behind the scenes. And I say that though time and chance happen to us all, though God sends his rain and his sunshine on the just and the unjust, though God, being on his throne, being in control, doesn't mean that he controls every little aspect of our lives. I say God really cares. He cares about us. He cares about the little things. He cares about the big things. And then we stop and say, is anything big to God? God really cares. He knows our needs, but he still desires that we bring them to him in humble obedience and in childlike trust and dependence. In closing this morning, Mordecai, I ask Esther, who knows that you've come to royal position for such a time as this? And I say, as believers in Christ, we have come to royal position. We have come to royal position. We're children of the heavenly King. And Peter uses this wonderful thought that's applied to the children of Israel in the Old Testament in saying in 1 Peter 2:9, but you are a chosen people, New Testament saints, believers, a royal people, priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. And having come to royal position, we can approach God's throne with confidence. Esther couldn't. There was trepidation on her part. Would the king extend the scepter or not? Not so with us. We can approach God's throne of grace freely and receive mercy and grace to help us in our time of need. We can ask for wisdom, as James says, chapter 1, to help us meet any and many trials that come our way. With position comes responsibility. And a chief responsibility is to glorify God by our submission, our obedience to him and to his son. And I say in closing that I believe that God gives us many opportunities to do just that throughout our lives. And may God give us the boldness, the courage to stand up for him and to stand up for his son Jesus for such a time as this.